Hello, good evening everyone. I will be doing a short stream before my internet cut off. Excuse me.
Well, over a decade, Sporky had been done. Thank you. Smorky, who changed up his art style and hired voice actresses so he could roleplay as 13-year-old girls who were upset with being poopy. He not only did it once, but twice! This was just even more confrontation. Smorky was a freak. There was no doubt about it now. Everyone joined in on the Kiwi Farms ready to dunk on it. Amanda, his voice actors, Lotax, even Lotax's kids got in on the dunking on Smorky. That's how much he got torn to shreds. Shortly before all this transpired, checked himself into a mental hospital. And after this all got unearthed, he left a concerning message on his Patreon and one last comic to his Tumblr. After that, Smorky has not been heard of since. 6 years later, and all traces of him have been lost.
Tale as old as the internet itself. But while some still remain in our lexicon as reminders,
Si Doris. Mamaya walang internet alas 10. Nag-text sa akin ng Royal eh.
La oras daw.
Hanggang alas 6 ng umaga.
Ha? Ang haba naman.
Oo nga eh.
Bakit daw?
Siguro gawa ng bagyo tsaka ulan. Pero hindi sinabi kung anong kung bakit eh.
Sabi nga pwede mo na daw pasukan ng
10 to 6.
You're a computer.
Why did you go underground, you freaky? Thank you.
Good thing, however, they never actually liked the attention, viewing memes as being Coffle's enormous profits, Rich no longer had to work a day job. And so, with his only responsibility being the site, he spent his free time with the lipstick provider. Yep. He had several brief relationships over the years. The first was a woman his mother introduced him to before moving to California. They celebrated her 21st birthday together with their meeting forever immortalized on video. In the background, several goons awkwardly crack jokes about a Linux computer they brought. Afterwards, he began a long-distance relationship with Emily Regal, who contributed under the username Integral. By 2002, the two were engaged, a promising step to their future. However, just a year later, the couple broke up, with details of their fallout publicly aired out on the front page. On March 18th, 2003, Lotex published an article titled What I Learned Last Week by Rich Kiyanka, age 26. In it, he advises the reader to never get involved with a crazy woman. He calls her a pathological liar, stating that she lied to him about her occupation and dating history. The final straw would be an incident in which the two had arranged to meet. Emily claimed that while boarding the plane, she was stopped by government officials and prevented from flying. He later discovered that his fiancé had lied, never having left home. By May, Lotex became wealthy enough to purchase a house back in his hometown of Missouri. Months later, he registered Something Awful as an LLC. It was becoming a legitimate business. Some admins even flown in to work full-time in his basement. In 2004, Rich began dating another member of the forum, a 23-year-old woman named Megan Austin. They began embarking on expensive international vacations together before she moved in with him for good. In attendance at the Cancun wedding were Schmorky as well as the Mega 64 crew. The relationship progressed at an alarming rate, one that spelled out disaster from the very beginning. In the moment, Rich was happy, and he chose to prioritize family over the form. By the time they had their second daughter, Jalen, in 2008, things had changed. Megan was always highly religious, while Rich hated Christianity. Megan wanted to protect her children from curse words, while Rich had no filter around them. These simple differences grew into deep resentment, to the point that they couldn't live in the same house together. In 2010, the couple made their first attempt at filing a divorce, though it was quickly dissolved by both parties.
Awful.
Using the Internet Archive, I was able to construct a rough fossil record of these. German Nissan GTR to the company. In early 2014, Rich and Megan finally divorced. He was ordered to pay her thousands every month for the next 3 years in alimony and child support. It's perhaps no coincidence that he announced the offices would be closed soon after. Rich put out an open invitation to anyone interested in visiting, offering free merchandise. It said that when someone passed out the couch with pills and empty bottles nearby. While visiting a friend in Canada, he was introduced to a young woman named Ashley Martin. Despite not being familiar with the site, they hit it off quickly, and by the end of the trip, she flew out with them to Missouri.
Goodbye.
Settlement, he began to suffer from a variety of medical problems. his neck completely broke apart, causing him to lose control of the entire nervous system. Was misdiagnosed as muscle pain, and took 3 months before doctors took him seriously. The pain was so intense
that he was
bedridden for 6 months. Even streaming became too difficult to do. The numerous hospital visits and appointments led him to accumulate a $16,000 debt. This forced him to withdraw his entire 401k, though it still wasn't enough. On March 12th, 2019, in a bit of desperation, Lotex wrote a lengthy post to the forum about the state of affairs. If something didn't change, he wouldn't be able to host the site any longer.
I've been seriously depressed for a couple years because my injuries and situation have severely limited the things I can do. It's made me feel absolutely useless and incapable of doing the things I want and need to do. I just want enough money to live, watch my children grow up, somewhat manage the things going on in something awful, and be happy. I just fucking want to survive and be happy with what I do.
Realizing just how dire the situation had become, users of the forum became sympathetic to their once distant father. They quickly mobilized and began donating to his Patreon. Within a day, it grew from a humble $2,000 to over $10,000 a month. Something awful had been saved from the brink of collapse, and Rich, as well as the rest of the internet, was thrilled. As his health improved, and with the site no longer in jeopardy, one would think he'd be in good spirits. This was the good ending, a happy conclusion. But everybody would be blindsided by what happened next. Because on November 25th, 2019, Rich posted on Facebook that his wife had kidnapped their daughter. In the post, Rich claimed that Ashley had taken $3,000 from his bank account, disabled her cell phone, and fled with their 2-year-old child. He immediately called the police, asking for an Amber Alert, only to be denied. Hours later, he wrote a second update with further context.
My wife and daughter are, according to the police, somewhere in the area. But they cannot tell me where, because if a woman claims to be afraid of a man, and they don't require any evidence to do so, they can take your family members and hide for as long as they want. This is absolutely fucking insane. I've never threatened or laid a hand on my wife, yet all she has to do is claim she's afraid of me.
Details on the alleged kidnapping were hazy at first. Many were sympathetic to Rich, believing that the incident was unjust. But then, more information about these circumstances began to surface. Rich had spent that entire month in Utah embarking on a supposed business trip. He carried with him a pitch for the sequel to Doom House, a classic Something Awful video. In reality, however, his intention was to hook up with the person he was meeting. Rather than celebrate Thanksgiving with his family, he was instead in Salt Lake City with a woman he met online. Despite his first marriage, he wasn't even visited in relationships. They still became intimate together, something he complained about publicly. Rich and Ashley had few common interests, which he couldn't even pretend to care about. These differences escalated to multiple domestic disputes, including one that allegedly ended with her slapping him. That December, Rich announced the formal pursuit of a divorce, proclaiming he'd have her deported back to Canada. He then used her phone to track down the exact shelter she'd escaped to, causing her to be moved by authorities for her safety. On January 21st, 2020, Ashley would speak publicly about the situation for the first time. That day, she created a GoFundMe with a detailed explanation as to why she left. She explained that Rich was in control of all her finances, making it impossible to save and leave. Ashley claimed that Rich used her undocumented status to control her, as seen publicly a month prior. The campaign asked for only $3,000 and was closed shortly after reaching the amount. That same day, Lotex's first wife Megan became involved with the case. That morning, she spoke to law enforcement out of fear for Ashley's safety. She affirmed that Rich was not only emotionally abusive, but physically abusive as well. As proof, Megan submitted a police report from during their marriage regarding a previously unknown incident. Dated March 26, 2013, it reads as follows.
Megan said her husband, later identified as Richard Kiyonko, was at their house, lying in bed about to fall asleep with their two children in between them. Megan said she had her phone in her hand. against her husband. Megan said her husband dug his fingernails into her fingers, forcing her to release the bone. While Rich denied the allegations to police, they observed blood and missing skin from multiple fingers on both of Megan's hands. Throughout the collapse of his second marriage, the woman he'd had an affair with moved in. The 25-year-old Logan Day believed Rich's side of events, as together they pursued a romantic and business relationship. She became the company's chief operating officer, which, as a longtime fan of the site, felt like a dream. As time went on, however, those rose-tinted glasses wore down. She began to stop seeing Rich as the man she thought he was, but instead the person he became. They started to get into arguments, and eventually, those two allegedly escalated to violence. On June 24th, 2020, Logan posted a distressing message to Facebook claiming that Rich had backhanded her to the floor. According to the police report, she'd attempted to wake him up, leading him to eagerly pick her up off the floor and throw her to the ground. She then revealed that the Patreon money was spent leasing that year's GTR model, as well as gourmet cookies. Shortly after these allegations were made, police reports regarding Megan Nash's abuse were also made public. With incredible accusations of abuse against Rich, people finally made their decision. That day, one of the writers on Something Awful published a letter directed towards Lotax, reading, "Lotax, you are the single source of every one of your problems. You allowed one of the best communities to accrue around you and then utterly, totally, completely squandered it. You are an active impediment to the site's success, and your refusal to sort your shit out will be the reason it dies forever. Maybe it should have died years ago." They then call for users to stop supporting him on Patreon. The goal allowed to effectively lose his entire audience, $8,000 every month, to just $1,000 overnight. In response, Lotax was streaming again for the first time in months, denying the allegations. He was a slurred, barely coherent mess, and filled the screen with a looping video of a dog puking. Many sympathized with him and paid respects for changing the online landscape forever. Now, he had no one. He continued streaming, barely able to maintain just 10 viewers. Even his oldest daughter, who acted as a sidekick during previous live streams, left him. And all he had left was a community who hated him. On October 9th, 2020, Rich officially signed away the rights to Something Awful, forfeiting the site and company to a 15-year member of the community named Jeffrey. His final words to the empire he built over two decades ago were goodbye. To commemorate the sale, both of Lotax's ex-wives took a photo together congratulating Jeffrey. Sold at the right time, Something Awful could have been turned into a multi-million dollar empire. When the forum was peaking in 2007, the declining e-bombs world managed to be sold for $15 million. Just recently, Gaming Forum Reset Era was acquired for $4.5 million. If Rich had sold at the right time, he'd never have to work again. And his various debts would have likely been no issue.
He was still having fun with the site and turned it down. He expressed lament at this to me during our own negotiations.
I bang it.
Was planning on leaving anyways and planned on starting a family, it would have been the responsible thing to do. Interestingly, he argued that Something Awful was never intended to be a big website, and he refused to sell even if it meant losing money because he had to keep this place true to himself. Whether you believe him or not, Something Awful was his life's work, an outlet of pure creative vision that evolved into one of the most influential communities of all time. And just like that, with nothing left to lose, it was sold. While the exact amount was never disclosed, it's estimated to be in the six figures.
2020, however, Ashley received her first legal victory. A custody agreement that allowed her to return to Canada with their daughter. Lotax, on the other hand, began streaming. A shadow of his former self, he spent most of 2021 live on the Gaming Garbage channel. There was little in the way of commentary beyond a drunken slurring and proclamations of innocence. He even decided to re-upload animations the disgraced schmork he had made of his daughters. When not playing video games, he was spending hundreds of thousands of dollars on luxury goods. Money that could have been saved for his children and their education was squandered for instant gratification. It's estimated he ran through nearly half $1 million. On November 8th, 2021, the judge also ruled that Rich had willfully spent the heroin.
That was fast.
In many ways, something awful grew in spite of him rather than because of him. With the continued success of the site's ideas and creators, the clear consensus that they could evolve while Lotax couldn't.
Ah.
Until his very last breath, he kept repeating the same mistakes. Eventually, people began to realize that they were mistakes but intentional decisions. In 2000, Rich began writing for an online gaming publication, Voodoo Extreme. The site was written by a man named Billy Wicked Wilson, with a sharp sense of humor defined the site. But despite this, he was an alcoholic and addicted to drugs, leaving Rich to fall into jail. It was cool that Billy was secretly depressed and though he had a loving family and children, he could not find happiness in life.
was the ex-owner of a little website you might know if you were my same age called Something Awful. Something Awful was a site like You're the Man Now, Dog, and it would have things like Ebon's World, where it would be like flashing memes. It was pretty much your first meme-type site.
Come on, Worm.
And a forum, too. That forum was the equivalent to like a 4chan forum where you could discuss a little bit of everything. But before that started, where did Lotax, the creator of the website, get his start? Well, he started out in college majoring in things like web design, IT, and things like that. He decided to go into working for a company that came out. Even Wolfenstein, if you want to go back that far, it was very, very easy to make levels in those games. In fact, you may remember the Columbine shooting had a level made by the shooters that was a direct copy of their school, so they could practice the shooting within Doom. Now, if that's really true or not, no one's ever really found out, but the fact that it could happen was very real. You could make any kind of level you wanted, and Quake was no different. People did that. They made their own levels. You worked at a website where they did the same thing. They also wrote reviews on different things added to Quake. This would be like mods. This would be pretty much like a Steam discussion area or a Steam mod workshop before Steam even existed. This is way, way back when the internet was still in its infancy, and a site like this was pretty amazing because there wasn't a place online where you could download these. In fact, this was still a time where if you wanted to get extra levels for your Quake game or Doom game, you went to a store like Barnes & Noble and bought a book that had a CD in the back that would teach you how to make the levels and also let you try out levels of other people. So having this online was very unique. It did really well, but Lotax didn't really get along with the crew that he was working with there, because even though he would write these articles about different Doom mods and Doom levels or Quake mods and Quake levels, some of the other writers that were there had to also write stuff that he didn't like, in the sense that they just weren't as good of writers as him. He was a talented guy. He had a lot of humor in what he wrote. He was quick-witted. And what eventually happened was one of the people who constantly wrote bad articles, he would constantly have to look over her articles and correct them again and again. And one day, he wrote a whole article about how he was sick of her articles being written at the company and that she was the worst writer the entire company had. And he published it on the company's website. He was later called into the office by the owner of the company and found out that the woman he had written this on was the niece of the CEO. So this didn't go over too well, and he was immediately fired. He had to sign an NDA. He was given 1 month of pay, and this was the time where he went off on his own and started to create Something Awful. Something Awful was a catchphrase, a motto, that he would constantly say about things he was talking about he didn't like. He would always say, that was something really awful, that was something awful. So he thought, why don't I make a website mocking everything that I find awful? And that's what he did. At first, it wasn't really going too well for him. It didn't really make any money, and he'd have to work a full-time job just to support hosting the website while also working on the website completely for free. He was literally losing money to keep people's stupid posts up, but they were funny posts. They were posts that were endearing and had somewhat of the wit of like old school Vine, memes of today, or things that just gave you a good chuckle when you came home from work and had a bad day. So what eventually got Lotax to finally try to get the site running on a profitable level was an offer from two different companies that were supposed Game Key companies, which means like you buy a game key from them. One is called Game Fan. The second one, I forget the subsidiary's name, but it was where they sold keys for games that were like pre-sold and you purchased the game. Unfortunately, he ran the ads for Game Fan. He never got the game. And later, he found out while reading the contract for Game Fan. Surprisingly, the company
Could be good. Could be good.
So that's what Lotax did.
But that depends.
$10 fee to join the site and use the forums in whole. And this surprisingly worked out really well. He literally had hundreds of thousands of people. And this also eliminated any spam or spam bots from the site, because obviously those people aren't going to pay to spam because they would lose money. It cleaned up the site significantly, made it look more professional, and also now became a big source of income for low tax. Also had a kid with him. He now has two daughters at this point, and unfortunately, we Judy's restaurant. He proceeded to drink.
Yeah, walk in.
In the Chinese restaurant, talking about how government spies were after him. It was so belligerent and so sort of schizophrenic that his wife began to break down and cry at the Chinese restaurant, begging him to stop. She was pregnant with his baby at the time, and this was really disconcerting in her first vision of what Lotez could act like when he was under the influence. This eventually did lead to them splitting up as well, but this time his new wife and his ex-wife joined together to, I guess, make a partnership to finally get money from being with him and dealing with his abuse. Now, you can have your own thoughts as far as whether or not you feel Lotax should have been sued or given alimony. If nothing else, he should pay for his children's education. I think we can all agree to that. And that is the other thing that they wanted out of him, to help them pay for bills, especially due to the fact that they were now single mothers taking care of his kids on their own. This didn't work out quite as well, and there was a lot of court procedures going forward. There was even multiple streams in which Lotax came on and tried to defend himself and talk about how he was not guilty of any of these matters. He had never hit a woman, never beat a woman, never touched a woman in the wrong way, never broken out into a wild rant or screamed and raved. But as his life continued, this started to appear to not be the truth. I'd say it really began when he had a major back injury and was diagnosed with having blown out one of his vertebrae on his back and had to have surgery, after which he of course had to take pain medication to manage the pain of a repairing disc in his back. But at the same time, it seemed like after this point is where he really got addicted to opioids, and this happens to lead to a greater downfall than I was ever imagining would happen for Lotex. There were people who tried to reach out. For example, the owner of Kiwi Farms tried to help him with his website and even talked to his ex-wife at one point, trying to get Lotex to convert the site to a new, updated, running new types of software that it will
maybe
allow
for casual have
instead of looking like a 1990s site.
Definitely
this
not.
Did not work out as well either. Neither would his security suggestions or his new forum rules that would allow him to better modernize and run his site. On top of this, another thing starting to drive Lotex a bit nuts was some of the members on the site were driving the entire thing into the toilet by doing crazy things like threatening the president, threatening to kill major politicians, so much so to their point that the FBI visited his house and questioned Richard Kayaka, or Lotex as you know him, because that's how I've called him for most of this video. When they did come, he actually went on the forums after that and yelled at everyone and went into a loud rant and rave. See, the thing is, though, the owner of Kiwi Farms, Josh, had actually tried to implement certain things that would help him weed out the bad characters, or at the very least, filter things that would trigger an FBI raid if they were being hosted within his farm. But Lotex was not concerned with this and wanted to run things his way. Lotex, while a great inventor and creator of a website that did quite well for a while, was turning out to be someone who's not open to change. At this point, change was something he really needed because his life was starting to fall apart. He was addicted to opioids, drinking massive amounts of alcohol, and losing complete contact with the members of his site. He also had lost his wife and his kids, who had moved away and would no longer see him anymore or hang out with him while he did his internet live streams. In fact, live streams were the last few things that he had left with interaction with the outside world. These turned into rambling online gameplay, some of which were so bad that during the time that his wife left him, he merely did a stream that was a JPEG or a GIF of a dog puking over and over
what to do.
While he rambled and cried about having lost connection to his wife and kids. I get sharing with your audience
the
pain that you're going through. I've done it myself when I was...
Need to do the bounties and the
requests. There's just certain things that you probably shouldn't share, especially when it deals with legal things.
I know my BTS max, but
and this would actually
I need the
more. aspects of his life because during this time, there was a class action lawsuit from his two ex-wives and kids attempting to get money to pay for minor things like housing, like education, like a college fund that would support them in the future. But he was not willing to pay any of these and fought them on every point. He was also completely disconnected from a lot of the people on the website that he had made, so much so that he was finally convinced to sell it by another member who wanted to run it a bit differently and finally modernize Something Awful. So Lojax did finally sell Something Awful, the last big thing about his life. At 45 at this point, he is severely overweight, addicted to pain pills, drinking alcohol on the daily. Everyone in his life has left him. His daughters, who used to come on his live stream with him, refuse to now because he was starting to use them. His live streams were only pulling in about 10 to 9 watchers at a time, which is kind of sad for someone who had run a massive forum full of people frenzied at every word he had to say. It was becoming a very...
revolver.
held it to his mouth and shot himself. That's right. At 45 years old, addicted to painkillers, drunk every night, live
streaming.
Los Angeles decided it was time to end himself.
Because
this ends tragically.
I'm sorry, no, I talking to my brother.
He lost his life, the women and his kids, lost all the money that he spent, and anything he would have had to fund for their education is gone. And so is the man who created something awful. You know, the weirdest thing is looking back through the log, everything Lotax did. There was one time where he worked for a very small gaming site. And this is not the Quake one I talked about earlier. There's a small gaming site that he worked for that he wrote articles for. And him and the other guy who wrote the articles on there were both really humorous and kind of dissed games all the time, made really funny reviews and stuff like that. But the guy he worked with at the time had a really bad addiction to methamphetamine.
That is the most Filipino name I ever heard. I just noticed that. Ay, manong peseng, halika dito. Punta sa bayan. FND. Oh, did I get?
Just really, really bad taste. This obsession with being alpha is so large that it has been used for at least two of his YouTube channels. Alpha Genesis, his well-known Steam channel, and Alphas Anonymous, where only alphas are allowed. You can tell he is an alpha by the state of his hair cuts, the excellence of which is solely down to him, as he cuts his own hair, and oh boy, does it end up in some form of creation. While supposedly being an alpha doesn't go aside, especially doesn't go away. Well, we all like that anyway.
Sega Genesis does mean is that he likes to bring up that he's an old father.
and daring, I suppose. I think this is the kind of thing that Boogie does, so he's trying to emulate that, somehow much less successfully though. Jared plays games on stream. However, because he lacks the intelligence to actually stream proper games, he doesn't actually stream anything decent, as he cannot figure out how to get chat working at the same time. To combat this, what he does is play cheap games and sketchy websites. And what happens on sketchy websites? Viruses. Viruses happen. Jared was adamant that he wasn't fazed by this, despite his face and voice clearly telling the opposite story.
Yeah, wait a minute, guys. Just having some technical difficulties. Am I still streaming? Because I think I lost my internet. Be right with you guys. Lost my game. Sorry, guys. I might have a virus on my computer. But, we'll get it taken care of. Awesome. Thanks for letting me know, Steve. Yeah, unfortunately, I caught a virus. Don't pirate, kids. Because eventually, it's going to catch up to you. So, oopsies. We'll see if I can get the game going again. I always wanted to change characters anyway. That guy was kind of slow.
This isn't the only thing. Of intelligence has been a big thing with him being terrible with computers in general, not just stupidity and playing games. Jared has essentially no knowledge of computers whatsoever. This would be fine. He's not really expected to. However, his ego makes this something that needs to be addressed, with him thinking that he is correct and just trying to deflect his failures. He once bought a pre-built PC, stating that this was the superior way of getting a PC, with it being cheaper and more effective in general than doing it yourself. When the computer failed to work, he actually had a mind game. Jared also doesn't think that having a computer gun is insistent for a computer, it would be just annoying to employ. Obviously, this is not how computers work, but you might like to know that Jared does actually use a computer phone. Mummy said so, which really says something about Jared, both intellectually and about his mentality.
I don't think that PCs really need fans. I mean, I think that it definitely can help. But if you're not someone who plays obsessively, then you really don't need them. I don't use these. I just take them off. It's funny because I think Dishonored Wolf or one of you guys, you thought this was a sink in one of my videos. It's just the side of my PC, bro. It's not a sink. I don't hide yo-yos in there. I mean, think of like a car, you know. A car doesn't have fans in the engine. Why does a PC need fans in it? You know, it's the same thing. It's a PC engine. You know what I'm saying? I just want to say, I still stand by what I said. I don't really think PCs need fans, although I do have one running on mine. It's only because my mom said that I have to use it, because she's afraid it would break if I took it off, but... Jason, seeing this Muppet, matched
paired up with another fighter who proceeded to absolutely dominate him, with Jason letting it happen. This has resulted in a long-term resentment from Jared, although has since wanted to join his gym and become an instructor.
How's it going, guys? It's Jared Genesis here, so I want to make this video to Kiyoshi Jason Day prank. He happens to watch this great, but if not, that's okay too. I still have a message that I want to share with other people. So here's the thing. I'm 33 years old. I've been practicing martial arts mostly on and off my whole life. Mostly self-taught. I know about 10 different styles. I want to be a martial arts teacher. I want to keep traditional martial arts alive. And that's why I wanted to contact Kiyoshi Jason David Frank. I understand that you run a traditional school in Kingwood, Texas called Rising Sun Karate. I would be very much interested in joining you, sir. Actually have been to your establishment in the past. This was roughly 6 years ago, I believe. I had a bit of an encounter, unfortunate encounter, with a Jason Felton, if you remember him. Pretty good guy. I mean, pretty advanced fighter. He was really good with kicking. And he really got the best of me. We did a sparring match. Unfortunately, though, I wasn't very happy about it, because I froze up, and he was just being pretty relentless with me, and unfortunately, I also went kind of a tyrant. And I said some ugly things, which I wish to apologize for. I'm sorry, the insiders. What I'm asking for is that you take care of one, keep it traditional alive.
So, you may be wondering as to why I've been so harsh on Jared in the introduction of this video, considering he's only shown himself to be a fool in what I've covered so far.
This is sure is handy.
That he really loves black people, only being able to reference people such as Bob Marley. However, despite these statements, all evidence points to the contrary. Jared is called Black Man, a gamer word on YouTube, for some reason. And when the recipient got offended about this, he got offended himself and tried to send his alpha army against the YouTuber.
And he basically blocked me off his channel after he told me off. You know, kind of like a girl move. You know how girls do that? They'll like act all autistic, laughing, and then block you so you can't respond back. I'm assuming this guy probably doesn't have a dad, because a lot of black people don't. So he has that sort of, you know, bitch attitude to him, that girl attitude. Talking that way to me ain't a good idea. I ain't a Yankee. And I told him some other things too that I won't say on here, but he got the message. And then he got all, you know, autistic, girly, like, racists aren't allowed on my channel. Shut the fuck up, man. I live in Houston, and although there are some racist people here, everyone down here is black. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't matter what color you are. It's very united. People are very united in the South. You know, places like New York or like, you know, Los Angeles. You got some really.
Well, just fuck off.
Racist type.
Seriously, those of these videos are annoying.
But in the South, you can be quiet and say this. Nobody would give a shit.
This isn't the end of this, as he's brought up slavery and blocked this, stating that the slaves in the world have freed themselves and that they kept themselves stuck. Clearly, I have a lot of insight into this topic. As well, they tried to compare slaves to himself by stating that he was also a slave mentally. The previous section could probably just be dismissed as extreme naivete. We know that Jared likes intelligence. However, this cannot be excused and totally disgusting. Jared is really what really likes to hear him alpha. And by this, I mean he disregards age completely. And they need to just be someone on a similar spiritual level as him, with him personally saying that they could be as young as 8 years old. Extremely fucking weird. This is why Jared has had such a hatred against Keemstar, as Keem blew this up, as obviously it is disgusting. To try and lighten things up a bit, maybe, it's still a dark subject, I'll show you a quick clip.
Anyways, guys, I had a lot of fun chat with y'all, man. I was having kind of a shitty day, because this girl
Oh, that's just a little.
Don't play with me, boys. I'm sick of this goddamn shit. I'm a grown-ass man, motherfucker. God damn it. Fuck you!
Jared really is the bottom of the barrel. Living with his parents in...
He's still alive. Not every concentrated piece, no. There's still more. It's almost maintenance for my internet, so I'll have to cut off stream today. I just wanna get out a short stream for now. Ayaka, I'm baffled you told me katana 3 times in a row. But yeah, thank you everyone for watching. I do hope you enjoy a relaxing stream from a relaxing stream. Let's see who we can raid right now. Jimmy Wolf is streaming today. Thank you everyone for watching. I hope you have a good morning, a good afternoon, and a good night. Please enjoy Jimmy's stream, and I will see you in the next stream. Take care. Thank you.